Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming the one and only Rabbi Daniel Lapin.
That's a bit heavy. It required it. Thank you very much indeed, Tommy. I appreciate that and wish my mom was alive to hear it. And thank you for the gracious introduction. Also, thank you to the academic advisor, Professor Anna Budd. I have no doubt that my entire outlook will be enormously enriched after the opportunity of spending some time with her this evening. And also, I want to express gratitude to Young America's Foundation, an organization for which I have the highest esteem and which I've had the privilege of being associated with for quite a long time. Is Amy Lutz here this evening? There she is. Thanks for coming. And thank you for inviting me and working together with Tommy and the folks here at the college. I appreciate that very much indeed. And there's an ancient Jewish rule I tell folks usually that requires the speaker's wife to be situated out of sight of the speaker. Now, this is entirely made up, but entirely necessary. And the reason is because my dear wife, who did me the enormous favor of homeschooling our seven children, has heard, not this speech, because I've never given exactly the speech, but the themes and the ideas, she has heard many, many times over the years. And she has a very honest face that reveals what she's thinking. And because she holds my entire ego in the palm of her hand, when she hears me say something that is not perhaps quite as effectively articulated as I did last week in Niagara Falls, then her face will show considerable dismay, which puts me off my stride. And so I usually prefer, if she is located for the speech, in some side room somewhere. But you didn't do that, in spite of my request. She's right there. Okay, that's quite enough of that. Thanks for coming, Susan. I appreciate it, really. It's no fun traveling without her, so here we are. Let me start off telling you about a guy called Samuel Colt. Samuel Colt was building revolvers in Connecticut in the early 1800s. Now, let me tell you how he used to do this. He had a big oak table, and he had six guys sitting around the table. And this table was in a workshop, and around the perimeter of the workshop were things like drill presses and vices and saws and all kinds of metal and steel working machinery. And then the guys would sit around the table, and each one would get up and find a piece of bar stock, and they'd take it over to the drill press and drill it down the center to make a barrel. And then they'll take another piece of metal and put it on the lathe and turn it and then put holes in it and it'll be a rotating chamber. And then each one would make a trigger assembly. Some of them were slower, some of them were faster. But whenever each man finished a revolver, he'd sign his name on the bottom of it and put it in a basket in the middle of the table. And each man used to finish a revolver in about a day and a half. And so, over the course of a day and a half, there'd usually be about six revolvers finished, and during the course of a week, there'd be, you know, 15 or 16 or 20 revolvers. And then Mr. Samuel Colt would come along, pick up the basket, and then he'd count each revolver according to the name signed on it, and then he would pay each worker according to the number of revolvers that he made during the course of that week. That was how the business went. In 1776, a few decades before this, a guy called Adam Smith, a Scottish religious thinker, philosopher, and what today we think of as an economist, although that term didn't sort of really exist back then. He wrote a book called An Inquiry into the Nature of the Wealth of Nations. A very earth-shaking, significant book in economic philosophy. In that book, he was the first person to come up with this idea of specialization. And what he said was, he said, look, you can never beat anyone at his own game, which, by the way, is a really, really useful thing for each of you to know. If you ever come up against a professional, in no matter what field it is, if you are an amateur and he or she is doing this day after day, year after year, they really are better at it than I am. It took me a long time to realize this. No, seriously, I mean, I used to enjoy repairing my car. And I thought I was pretty good at it. And it took a long time before I wised up and discovered that my nice German engineer, the guy who works at the auto house, could fix my car much, much better than I could, much quicker than I could, releasing me to use my time for things that I did best and got paid for. And it took me a long time to realize. I used to think, hey, you know what, I've worked on my car for a couple of years. Yeah, maybe. You still don't know what you're doing. Because he's been doing it every day for 20 years. Professionals, you can't beat. And so Adam Smith realized that if people would specialize on a particular task, they would become far better at it than they were when they were doing a whole bunch of things at the same time. So Samuel Colt reads about the discoveries of Adam Smith, and he reorganizes his factory, not to the pleasure of those six workers. But here's what he said. He said, gentlemen, you're not going to like this very much, but I'm the boss. I'm still going to do it this way. And I want you to stick with me for 3 months. At the end of 3 months, we can reevaluate it. We'll talk about how we feel about it then. But here's what we're going to do. And he said to the first guy, he said, Abel, you are going to make barrels. Bob, you are going to make trigger assemblies. Charlie, you are going to make the rotating chamber. David, you are going to make the handle. And the last two, he said, guys, your job is to assemble everything together. Now, you all have to work much more accurately than you used to, because you were each making one revolver at a time. And so you could adjust and file and saw and drill a little bit till everything fitted. But now, the last two guys are going to reach into the basket in front of you. They're going to pull out one barrel, one trigger, one handle, one rotating chamber, one sights assembly, and then they're going to put it all together. Everything has to fit. This was a big breakthrough. First time this ever happened. And so Samuel Colt said, I'm going to give you jigs so everything lines up. Every piece is going to be interchangeable. Big, big breakthrough. They do it, and what happens? The next thing that happens is no longer are they making five or six revolvers every day or so. Now, all of a sudden, they're making three times the number of revolvers. At the end of the first week, Samuel Colt comes along to pay all the men, and each man gets literally three times the number of dollars that he got last week and the week before and the week before that and the week before that. They couldn't believe their eyes. The next week, even better. They're getting better at what they do. And from then onwards, not only Samuel Colt, arms concern in Connecticut, but factories all around the Northeast. In those days, factories were mostly driven by water wheels. And everybody switched to doing this. Now, the question I have to ask is, why does this work? And what's the idea? I get the idea that people get better at what they do, and if you have people doing the same thing, people can do it faster, and the whole process of building is much more efficient. I get that. It makes a lot of sense. But don't forget, I'm a Jewish rabbi, and my information comes from a book that shaped Western civilization. It's called the Bible. And some of you may be familiar with it. Some of you may not be familiar with it. Some may know it and read it and be and really know it. Others may be completely disinterested. It doesn't matter. I don't really care whether you regard it as the Word of God or if you regard it as a fascinating book of which more copies have been printed than of any other book in all of human history. I don't know whether you are intrigued by the irony that before he passed away, at the end of the 18th century, the French philosopher Voltaire predicted that within 100 years, the Bible would be completely out of print and unavailable. In one of those supreme moments that persuaded me personally that God has a really, really good sense of humor, the house in which Voltaire lived for most of his life was sold to the Geneva Bible Society. And they set up a printing press in the basement of the house from which so far 180 million Bibles have been sent all around the world, all from Voltaire's house. How many of you in this room, just as a matter of interest, own a copy of the complete works of Voltaire? Wow. Just as a matter of interest, how many of you happen to own a Bible? Wow. Interesting. So in that case, I feel comfortable telling you something about the Bible. End of the book of Genesis, here's something really interesting. Father Jacob, who is otherwise known as Israel, again, I'm not going to go into the details are irrelevant. Right now, I only want to talk about the economic impact. Father Israel is about to die at the end of the book of Genesis, and he gathers his 12 sons all around him, and he says, come near me, I want to bless you all before I leave. And it then takes about 30 verses, because he goes on and on and on and on and on. He goes son by son. Reuben, this is what you're going to be doing, and Levi, this is you, and Judah, this is you, and Dan, this is you, and Zebulun, this is you. This takes a lot of time, and not to mention a lot of ink. If I were writing the Bible, here's what I would have said. Jacob drew near to death. He called his sons together to bless them before he went home to the Lord. And he said, boys, I've lived for 147 years. Most of the time was fine. A lot of the time, some of you were a real pain in the neck. But anyways, God bless you all. I'm out of here. One verse, not 30 verses. I'd be a fabulous editor. As if this wasn't enough, the end of the book of Deuteronomy, Moses is about to die. He's just led the Israelites 40 years through the desert. God says, you know what, you screwed up a couple of times. I'm not letting you go into the promised land, but that's how it is. I will let you give a final blessing to the Israelites. Moses starts again, same thing, tribe by tribe, tribe of Reuben, tribe of Levi, tribe of Judah, tribe of Gad, tribe of Dan, all the way through. Again, you know, a whole chapter. If it was me, one verse. Moses climbed the mountain and spoke to the children of Israel, and he said, it's been a tough 40 years. You are a tough bunch. I want to tell you that. You really have been a tough bunch. If I wasn't your leader, I'd be an anti-Semite. I'm allowed to say that. I'm circumcised. And but it's been 40 years. I'm going home to the Lord. God bless you. Take you into the land. From now on, you're Joshua's problem, not mine. One verse. Instead of 30, what's going on there? Well, It's very simple. In order to explain, I have to tell you about something very clever that my wife did. There was a time where two of my daughters wanted to try out school instead of homeschooling at home. So off they went to a boarding school in another city. And her concern, and mine was too, that she didn't want them to lose closeness with one another. You know what I mean? Kids, they've been very close, siblings, homeschooling, a lot of family togetherness. And then what happens? They're now going off to this big bustling school with a whole lot of students, and these two sweet little Lapin girls are going to find themselves now disconnected from everybody. They're going to make new friends. They're not going to stay as close to one another as they used to. So here's what Susan did. Susan took two pieces of paper, and she wrote a letter to each of them, putting an alternate word on each paper. What ended up with, each girl then received a letter in the mail, completely unintelligible, because it's got every second word. The only way for them to read a letter from home and catch up on all the news from the family was to get together. And they had to put their papers together and read them together, and they'd have gales of laughter as they were giggling at how silly mommy was for doing it like this, but it achieved our goal to make absolutely sure that twice a week they got together. You may be getting a clue as to what's going on with Israel and with Moses. In order to really get it clear, can we jump back to Connecticut, early 19th century? I want to ask you to think through what happened in the old original Samuel Colt revolver factory when one of the men didn't show up for work. What was the attitude of the other five guys? Didn't care, exactly. They didn't care. Why should they? All it meant is that at lunchtime there'd be a little more beer for them. Who cares? Get it? Now, how about the new model of the Samuel Morse revolver plant? What happens now? A guy doesn't show up for work, and everybody, the other five guys, say, you know, where's David? I don't know. Quickly, we got to go over to his house and see if he's all right. And they run over to the house and they say, David, are you okay? And he says, yeah, I'm okay, but my wife isn't well, and I couldn't come to work. All the kids are taken care of. What do the other five guys say? Tell us what to do. We'll help you. We'll take care of it. Because we can't do anything without you. Now, just put yourself in the mind of a religious perspective, regardless of whether you're religious or not. But put yourself in the mind of trying to understand, which would God prefer? Human relationships, where we care for one another, and where our entire identities are shaped by the people in our lives. And the more different they are from us, the more they think in a different way, the more they contribute, the more they make us grow, the more they make us into the kind of people we want to become. And so specialization is another way of situating human beings in a way that they need one another. If I made all my own clothing and all my own shoes and all my own needs, I wouldn't need anybody. But I spend a lot of time on my feet, and I found it very difficult to find shoes that are comfortable to stand in for a long period of time. But I did. I found a pair of shoes. And I literally pray for the welfare of Allen Edmonds Shoe Company. I do, because I really don't want them to go out of business. Companies go out of business, you know, it does happen. And I really don't want to start looking for a pair of shoes that works for me. The only way that happens is if I didn't make my own shoes. And that is why Israel blessed his 12 sons separately, to make sure that each son would need the others. When you have a neighborhood, a society, a community, a culture, where everybody is a subsistence peasant, where everybody takes care of only his own needs, each and every person grows his own potatoes and his own wheat, and each person keeps dairy cattle, and each person keeps sheep, and each person weaves his own cloth for clothing, What's the relationship between everybody? They see no relationship, or at best, they see one another as competitors for resources. But when you set up a system of specialization, now all of a sudden we're allies in the struggle to wrest a living from an often reluctant earth. We're allies because I can't do it without you, and you can't do it without me. So it's no surprise to a religious person. It's no surprise that God creates a beautiful economic incentive. He says, if you specialize, I'll let you make 3 or 4 or 5 or maybe 10 times the money you were making before. And that gives you more options in life. That's a good thing. In 1953, in May of 1953, an interesting thing happened. A guy called Edmund Hillary went with his friend Sherpa Tenzing Norgay up to the very top of Mount Everest. Never been done before. And they came down. It was an unbelievable achievement because all the indications up to then were that no human being could make it. Nearly 30,000 feet, very little, very thin air, almost no oxygen. The weather is appalling, the conditions are terrible. It couldn't be done. But Edmund Hillary and Tenzing Norgay did it. I wonder if any of you know approximately how many people have climbed Everest since then. Would you say 10, would the number, the order of magnitude be closest to 10 people since then, 100 or 1,000? Yeah, it's well over 1,000 people have climbed Mount Everest. I'm not saying I could do it. Okay, you didn't need to laugh at that statement. I expected a more sympathetic, oh, come on. But many of you here could well do it if you set your mind to it, if you wanted to. So many people are doing it that there's actually, did you know there's a litter problem on Everest? People drop candy bar wrappers because it just takes too much energy to bend down and pick them up or do something else with them. But there's a lot of people doing it. Why didn't anybody do it before May 1953? Why did it wait till Edmund Hillary and Tenzing Norgay? Why did nobody do it till then? Because they didn't believe that it could be done. Wow. Only 1 year later, May 1954, a guy called Roger Bannister does something which not only didn't anyone think could be done, but people were sure would kill an athlete in the attempt. A 4-minute mile was not possible. Do you have a 4-minute miler at this college? I bet you do. I wouldn't be at all surprised. Do you have an athletics program here? Yeah, you probably do. How many people have run a 4-minute mile since Roger Bannister did in May 1953? Thousands. Not saying I could. You never learn, do you? That was a test. All right, anyways, it doesn't matter. Why didn't anyone run a 4-minute mile before? Because they didn't believe that it could be done. Nobody can truly succeed at any activity that deep in their hearts they consider to be morally reprehensible. Nobody can ever succeed at any activity that deep in your heart you believe you cannot do. The day will come for all of you when you will want to have a few dollars in your pocket. The day will come eventually. I don't know what the circumstances will be, but the day will come when you will want to make a few dollars. And I have to tell you that as a group of fairly privileged Americans, in the sense that you are at a top-rate school and you are on a track which is going to lead you to desirable academic credentials, I have to tell you that it is extremely unlikely that anybody in this room is going to make their money as a result of incremental raises in the minimum wage. It's probably not going to happen. You're all going to find a way of making money. And you're going to do it through some form of economic interaction called business. You may accept a position in exchange for a salary. You might work for somebody. You might go into partnership with somebody, whatever it is. But pretty much everyone here is going to find a way to make some enviable money. Your ability to do that is distinctly handicapped if deep in your heart you believe that making money is immoral. And so what I'd like to do with the rest of the time that I have available this evening, let me check to see. Okay. What I'd like to do in the rest of the time I have available is give you as much as I can in the form of valuable tips, tools, techniques, and strategies that are a part of ancient Jewish wisdom, that have been a part of Jewish economic success, not only in great countries like the United States, but also in oppressive regimes. And not only in good times, but also in shockingly bad times. There is a reason, and what it is, things that we want to talk about, things I want to impart to you. Because if you have a clearer sense of what money really is, your ability to function with it and your ability to make it when the time comes to make it is going to be incredibly enhanced. That's what I'd like to share with you now. And so let's start off with a story of a home on a beautiful island in the Pacific Northwest, belonging to my wife and myself. It's a home situated right in the middle of this island, and the island is in a beautiful lake, in a beautiful area, in a beautiful state, state of Washington. And what... Would you like to just tell me how much time you need for this? I can carry on when you're done.
You sat through your talk, you justify genocide people.
All right.
All
right. Okay, listen, we're not going to enter into a cross argument here. You've had your say. We've heard you. If you have anything new to add to it, I don't want you to repeat yourself because we get bored real quick around here. So if you've got anything new to add, say it now. I'm giving you a chance, and then I'd like to continue doing what people expect me to do here now. Great question, and if you sit down, I will answer it. Sit down, put away your poster now. If that was a genuine question, I'm taking you at your word, I would like to answer that. I will get to it. Sit down now. Go on. This is a real novel idea. We have a conversation.
We are having a conversation.
Right. But the audience is seated, the speaker is standing. So why don't you sit down now? That would be the polite thing to do. You've had your say. I've listened to your question. Sit down now and let's carry on. Shall we do that? Come on, folks. Let's not make this any more ridiculous than it really is. Do you want to become... All right. Are you sitting down? If you ask a question, I presume it's because you ask it in good faith. That's what I thought. Right? So you want an answer, don't you? So sit down, I'll tell you the answer. You're only going to stand and make yourself uncomfortable. Don't do it. Sit down. Come on. I thought your question was asked in good faith.
You can still answer with
Yeah, I would like you to sit down. Okay, folks. All right, in that case. All right. Okay, believe me, I don't know what your protocol here is. I don't know what your protocol here is, but I don't know if you have a way of removing people who disrupt something that everyone else wants. I have absolutely no idea. But I do know that there is a level of moral and civilized behavior that is expected in the realm of scholarship and civilized discourse, which is being violated now in a way which is, it's laughable and pathetic.
Laughable
so,
and pathetic.
Okay, that's enough. Good. Okay, it's very nice, and maybe you can hold a lecture in another room telling folks all about it. Okay, but right now, this is my lecture, and you're being very, very rude, not only to me, but to your fellow students. Is a rule in the physical space-time continuum, which is that any physical object can only occupy one place at any given time. So, for instance, if this jar of water is sitting here, and I turn my back, and by the time I turn back around, it's no longer here, but this gentleman in the front row is holding it. I think I can safely conclude that he took it away from me. Because it was here a minute ago, now it's there. I don't see a whole bunch of these around the room. There was only one. I had it, now he's got it. He took it. That's because this is physical. And if you take a physical thing from one person, then what you are leaving them with is a negative, a minus. You're taking it away from them. So consequently, if you live in a world where there is no spiritual reality, and please remember, it may have been hard and noisy for you to hear this, I repeat it, spiritual doesn't mean religious, doesn't mean godly, doesn't mean virtuous, there's good spiritual, there's bad spiritual. Spiritual means very simply only one thing, that which cannot be measured in a laboratory, that's all. That's what spiritual means. And so, if money is only physical, then it is obvious that if you have some, it's only because me and others have less. Because something can only be, a physical thing can only be in one place at a time. If you got it, it means I don't have it. Spiritual would be more like a tune. If I have a tune and you hear me whistling it, and the next thing is, you're all walking around whistling that same tune. Am I hurt? No, I live in a now more musical world. It's a good thing. Because you cannot take spiritual things away from people. You can only take physical things away from people. And so, we need to take a look quickly, and I'll bring it in for a landing here so I can be available to answer questions. But we need to look at only one thing now, and that is actually how this does work. Are there any accounting majors? All right, just to make sure that I don't pull any rabbinic smoke and mirrors. I just want to make sure there's some watchdogs who'll be able to see that I don't pull anything fast here. Okay, we're going to take a look at Grandpa Lapin. Grandpa Lapin was a peddler, okay? He used to drive his truck around from small town to small town. He'd knock on doors, do trades. Sometimes on one visit, a housekeeper, a wife or a business, somebody might say, hey, can you get us a this or a that? And he'd make sure that 3 weeks later when he came through the town or the village again, he'd have that. He was welcomed. He used to satisfy needs. So we're going to take a real quick look
at a day in the life of Grandpa Lapin. And we're going to make it really short. We're going to leave out closed doors. We're going to leave out nobody heard stories. We're going to make this simple, straightforward. Everything works smoothly. Grandpa Lapin knocks on house number one, okay? Lady comes to the door and he says, "Hi, do you have anything here that you don't need?" And she thinks for a moment. She says, "Well, we do have the table. We're getting rid of an old table." He says, "What are you doing with it?" She says, "We're putting it out in the alley, and on Tuesday, the city will come by and pick it up and take it away to the dump." Grandpa Lapin says, "For free?" She says, "When does government ever do anything for free?" Grandpa Lapin says, "You've got a point. What are they charging you?" She says, "They're charging us $5 to take away our old table." Grandpa Lapin says, "Have I got a deal for you? I will give you $5 if you help me load the table on my pickup. I'll give you $5. She couldn't be happier. They load the thing on Grandpa Lapin's pickup. And just before they drive away, I want to ask you all, how has the financial statement of this family improved? By how much? By Grandpa Lapin knocking on their door?
$10.
$10. Beautiful. When I asked this question at Harvard Business School, 4 of the professors said 5. It's true. It's right. You all got it exactly right. She no longer has to take it out of her pocket $5 to give to the city. So she's got that $5 back. And Grandpa Lapin gave her 5. She's up $10. Grandpa Lapin stops at the hardware store, pays $1 for some paint and some nails, nails up a wobbly leg, paints some scratches out on the table, knocks on the second door. Lady opens the door and he says, "Hi, anybody here need a table?" She says, "Well, you know, my daughter's getting married next week. Maybe she does. We'll check with her." So they call the daughter. She comes out and they say, "Hey, Grandpa Lapin says, what are you doing for a table for your new home?" She says, "We were thinking of going to the furniture store at IKEA and getting a table." Grandpa Lapin says, "How much was the table going to cost you?" She says, $20, unassembled. So Grandpa Lapin says, "Well, out on my pickup truck, I've got a table. Now, mind you, it's used. It had a scratch. I painted it out. It had a wobbly leg. I nailed it. But you could have that for $10. She says, save 50%? Of course I want to do that. Let me take a look at it. Go. She says, "This is plenty good enough." They carry it to the house and leave it there. And now I need to run a quick check again. How much better off is this family because Grandpa Lapin stopped by?
$10.
Also 10, right? Because they were going to pay 20, but now they only have to pay 10. You with me?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. So as a whole, oh, by the way, some of you are feeling sorry for IKEA. You don't have to, because nothing has changed for them. Whatever inventory they had yesterday, they've still got today. Nothing has changed. They are where they were. But family number 2 is up $10. Family number 1 is up $10. So aggregate village-wide, how much better off is this village because Grandpa Lapin swung by?
$25.
Do you remember the dollar he spent at the hardware store? $21. The village is better off. And now, look, here's the hard question. Get this right, and I'll let you out early. This question is, how much arbitrage is in Grandpa Lapin's pocket? What profit does he have? You're so good. That's right. If you work the problem backwards, start with the second family and then do the first, you'll see how it works out. Second family gave him $10, right? He gave one of those dollars to the hardware store, so he's got 9, and he gave 5 to the first lady. So he's left with 4. Even though in reality it worked in the other sequence, the other direction, the arithmetic can work forwards or backwards, same thing. So Grandpa Lapin's better off by $4. The village is better off by $21. This is a miracle. Where did all this come from? How did this happen? It's like smoke and mirrors. No! Remember I told you the difference between candles and cake? And the difference between tunes and saxophones? There's no limit to how many people can have the tune. And in reality, that's exactly what happens. Now, for those of you who still harbor lingering doubts about me, Some of you still think I'm pulling a fast one. Let me remind you that there's only one company that made money on the internet from day one. Not Amazon. They lost money for 7 years. But what company made money on the internet day one? Sorry? A company that lets people do what Grandpa Lapin did.
eBay.
Now, I checked up with eBay to see how many transactions typically are going on at any given instant on eBay. Do you know what the answer is, by the way? Anyone want to guess? 70,000 is the right answer. 70,000 transactions are going on any moment on eBay. You want to know what the best definition of eBay is? 70,000 Grandpa Lapins working simultaneously. That's all it is. What eBay or Grandpa Lapin is doing is saying, oh, something you don't need, I'll get you money for it. And then they go to other people and say, something you need, I'll get it for you cheaper. That's what eBay does, morning, noon, and night. And guess what they have in their pocket? A little arbitrage, a little profit. That is how money is made, when human beings serve one another. That's what makes it work. When human beings serve one another, money is brought into existence. If you think that money is made when the United States Treasury runs the printing presses and produces currency, then none of us should ever be short, right? They should just run the press until we all go, oh, stop, stop, we got enough already. But they can't do that, because if you print, if you're a country and you print more money than is equivalent to the things that human beings have done for one another in terms of goods or services, you have something called inflation, which is another way of stealing money from citizens. That's what it is. And so if you imagine, maybe what I should do is just try and find a landing place on this right now, so then we can go to some of your questions and answers here. So the bottom line is, why is it moral to make money? Let me put it this way. I often ask people, do you want a lot of money? Now, a lot of people get very uncomfortable with the question. They sort of move their feet around and they sort of look down. And people are uncomfortable about saying, yes, I want a lot of money. Because they think it makes them sound greedy. They also think that the love of money is the root of all evil, etc., etc. But I never said anything about the love of money. I said, you want a lot of money. But I didn't ask you why. If I asked you why and you said, because I love money. But how about if I ask you, do you want a lot of money? And you say yes. And I say, why? And you say, because it will prove that I've served a lot of human beings. Well, now that's very interesting. So imagine that there was a nice kosher restaurant in San Mateo. I don't think there is. But if there was, okay, and I wanted to take my wife there for a nice big fat kosher steak and a plate of fries, I would need to do something before that. Here's what I would do. Let's imagine I'm a roofing person and I'm about to go roller skating with my kids, and then all of a sudden the phone goes and is Dr. Carlson here? Where? There you are. Your kitchen starts leaking. It's raining. You call me and you say, listen, this is really miserable. The rain's coming through my roof. Could you come over quickly and do a roofing job? And I'm just about to say, Dr. Carlson, I cannot do that. I'm about to walk out of the house with my kids to go roller skating. And I'm, oh, you idiot. How could you even think of doing that? This is a great opportunity to teach my children what money is all about. And I say, well, of course I'll come over immediately. And I get my tools onto the truck, I take my kids, pack them in the back, and off we ride over to their house. We climb up on the roof, set the ladder, bring up some shingles, fix it all up, pretty soon, I've got the rain under control. No more rain coming into the kitchen. She's as happy as could be. And she says, that was really beautiful. Is there anything I can do for you? And I say, sure. I need some certificates of performance. She says, what are certificates of performance? I say, simple. They're little green strips of paper like this with different numbers on them. And they prove that I served you. She says, oh, I know about what you mean. I've got a bunch of those. How many do you want? I say, well, could I have 100, please? She says, with pleasure. I'm so relieved you came over here to take care of my roof. So I take the $100 and I come running home and I say, Susan, we're in luck. We're going out tonight to Easy's Kosher Grill House in San Mateo. Doesn't exist. I checked. And so we run down to Easy's Kosher Grill. We sit down and Izzy, I presume, walks over and says, what do you folks want? I said, we want two big, fat, juicy steaks with a plate of fries. He says, and why exactly should I go and slave over a hot stove in my kitchen just because you want to eat a steak? I say, excuse me? I thought I saw the word restaurant outside there. He says, yes, but this restaurant is only for members of a certain club. I said, really? What's that? What is this club about? This is a club for people who like serving other people. I said, oh, that's me. He says, really? Can you prove it? I said, sure I can. Where do you think I got these from? He says, oh, fine. I'll sit down. Brings us a beautiful steak, fantastic to eat. We enjoy it. At the end of it, I say, what can I do for you? He says, I'd like you to give me some certificates of performance. I said, sure, how many? He says, 60. No problem. Here you go. And the next day, he takes his kid to the orthodontist, and so it continues. That is the definition of money. Forget everything they told you in Econ 101. The definition of medium of exchange, etc., etc., etc. Money is very simply evidence that you have served another human being. In other words, if any of you, now or tomorrow, have some money in your pocket, and you absolutely did not defraud anybody, and you didn't rob a little old lady and take her pocketbook, and you didn't hold up a convenience store, then I know how you got that money. I don't even know you, but I know how you got the money. It's very simple. You pleased another child of God. You pleased another human being. That's how it works. Very, very simple. Very simple. And so the answer is that if you've got money in your pocket and you didn't steal it or rob it or defraud anybody, you've got that money. I don't know if it's your boss or your customer or your client or a relative. I don't know who gave it to you. But somebody gave it to you whom you did something for that was worth more than the money. In exactly the same way that to the second family, that table was worth much more than the $20 or the $10 that they gave for it. That is the secret of money. Making money is terrific. And you don't have to expiate the sin of making money by giving charity. That's a totally different discussion. I absolutely believe that for a person who is an ambitious entrepreneur, not to give away 10% of what you make is sheer folly. I think it's an unbelievable mistake. Not from a godly point of view, but from an economics point of view. And I explain that in more detail in my books. I'm not trying to sell books now, so I'm not going to go into that for now. But bottom line is that charity isn't to make up. And I tell you this because there's a horrible phrase that's very popular out there. You all heard it. And as soon as I start saying it, you'll know exactly what the phrase is. You hear it every time Bill Gates or Apple or Google or anybody makes a big gift to a hospital or to an art gallery or to Africa or anything else. Everyone says, isn't it lovely to see them giving back to society? I ask you, ladies and gentlemen, what does that mean they were doing to society while they were making the money in the first place? Ripping it off, obviously. And that's what people believe. And all of this wrong-headed thinking is why it is that those pathetic cretins outside have such a confused idea about what money is. Now, note that I'm not necessarily speaking in favor of capitalism, because capitalism is an economic system, and I'm not sure that it includes an ethical component. What I'm talking about is an ethical approach to money, where the way I make money is by serving other human beings. It brings me closer to other people. It doesn't drift me further apart. The morality of money is precisely that, that you cannot make money in an open, free market without making other human beings happy. And when you make other human beings happy, and this I'm telling you only from a personal point of view, because I have no idea if any of you are religious or who's religious or who isn't, it doesn't make any difference. But there's no way, let me put it this way, those of you with children, and if you haven't got children, one day you will find out. If somebody does a wonderful thing for your child, is that as good as doing a wonderful thing for you? Not as good or better?
Better.
Much better, right? If somebody does something great for your kid, you want to throw your arms around them in gratitude. How do you think the good Lord feels when we take care of one of his kids? Do you know why I and virtually every single other American, when we check out of a hotel, as I'm going to do first thing in the morning, why do I leave money on the table for housekeeping staff? They get paid. Why do I do that? Why do I tip the waiter like almost every American? I do it because I have to show my appreciation for what that person did for me. Susan and I arrive in the hotel, we were tired, long travel, exhausted, everything's beautiful, everything's clean, the lights work, the bathroom looks like no human being's ever been in it before. Everything's terrific. I have to say thank you for that. The fact that the hotel pays them has nothing to do with me. I have to acknowledge that they did something for me. The fact that they don't know me, it doesn't matter. So you've got to be aware that getting paid doesn't diminish the virtue of the action. As a matter of fact, if I'm doing a modification to my house and the contractor says, you know, I'll do it as a favor for you, do you think that makes me happy? Yeah. Of course not. I don't want a favor from him, because if it's a favor, he'll have to fit it in to whenever he has time. If it's a favor, he might want to use second-rate material so he doesn't lose too much on it. I want him to charge me enough so he makes a fair profit. And if I consider the profit to be too much, I'll go to someone else. That's what a marketplace means. I don't want him to do it for free. A volunteer, very nice, but it doesn't suit me. Because a person who does it for me as a favor is not somebody I can call back and say, by the way, you know what? I didn't like the shade you painted this wall. Can we redo that? They did it as a favor. You're stuck. I like transactions. I like contracts. I like deals. Because that's what brings people together. It doesn't drive them apart. Let's take some questions, and I'll try and answer them, and we'll try and move ourselves along quite quickly, because I know people have to be out of here. If we're out by about 9:15, is that good for people? Yeah. All right. I mean, I'm not going to go anywhere until the last one is out. I turn off the lights, but I don't want to keep people. If people have to leave, you have to leave. But anyways, if anyone wants to ask me anything, please go ahead and do that. Yes.
So you were just talking about charity earlier briefly.
Yes.
That brings up just some personal, like, I don't know whether you would describe it a fallacy or just some type of logical problem I have. A lot of people talk about like eliminating welfare programs and government safety nets because charity as a whole would take it over. And from, like, if you look at it from purely a market standpoint, like you said, that would make sense. But like, what I see is that there are going to be people out there who aren't going to donate money to charity. You know, like, for an example, my mother came from a very poor, like, dirt poor background, and she's rather wealthy now, but she doesn't donate money to charity just because, you know, she was raised.
It's not the poor. It's a problem.
So would you say that in that case, minimal, like, government intervention would be, like, as safety nets would be justified?
You know, I don't want to pose as a public policy expert.
Yeah.
And a great deal of what politicians trade in is speculation. And another thing that politicians tend to do is postpone the day of reckoning for the guy who's in office after me. So I don't want to say, well, we can just go ahead and leave this all with the private sector.
Right.
I will say this, that a legitimate question to ask somebody on welfare is, would you explain to me why my kid has to go with a little less this Christmas so that you can have? I'm not saying I'm unhappy about it. I'm not saying I'm unwilling to help you, but I do want to make sure that you don't regard what you are receiving from your fellow citizens as an entitlement.
Right.
Because I have an obligation to give charity. I don't have an obligation to give it to you or to you or to anyone else. I just got to give it to somebody.
Right.
And you don't have a right to my money, ever. You have no right to my money, ever.
Okay.
So I do think that if welfare recipients, and I do understand people fall on tough times, and obviously people need a leg up. I've been there myself. People do need help. I do believe it's just as important to maintain their dignity as it is to maintain their income.
Yeah, through adoptions.
And there are ways that private organizations do that more effectively than government does. Government also has vested interest in preserving a bureaucracy, an entire state. So I would commend to your reading on this subject, if you haven't yet read it, it's a book called Wealth and Politics by a fantastic economist who lives only a few miles from here. His name is Thomas Sowell.
Sowell.
I'm going to mention something which I hate doing, but our environment has made us so absurdly conscious of the physical instead of the spiritual. I'm going to say it anyway, though I hate saying it, and that is, he happens to have a black skin. And it's kind of interesting, because when you read the statistics and what he has to say about welfare, it's going to blow your mind and shine laser-like beams of clarity onto this whole question.
Yes.
Name is Thomas Sowell, and it's Wealth and Politics.
Thank you.
You're certainly welcome. Yes.
So prior to hearing you speak, as we were talking about coming to this, is it immoral to make a lot of money? My response would have been no, because then you have more to give.
Right.
Right? But as I hear you talk, and I just want to clarify, would you agree with that statement, or do you think that we are to make money because it's our purpose on earth, because if we have made money, we've served a fellow human being? It doesn't have anything to do with giving.
In the 1600s and the 1700s, there really were pirates of the Caribbean, you know. There really were. And the part, you all know that, but here's the part I bet none of you know. And that is, a goodly number of them were Jews. Now, I take great pleasure in that, because it means there's an alternative career path if this rabbi stuff doesn't work out. You know what I mean? So who were these people? These were people who were thrown out of Spain by the Spanish Inquisition in 1642. Susan, am I right on that date?
No.
1492. Sorry, I thought it didn't sound right. They kicked out of Spain in 1492.
Their parents and grandparents were kicked out.
Yeah. Many of them settled in Holland. Later on, Holland and England were allies in the war against Spain. So these Jews in Amsterdam went to the Spanish, to the Dutch government, and they went to the British government, and they said, would you give us letters of marque allowing us to pray on the open oceans on Spanish ships? The British said, with pleasure. The Dutch said, you bet. And so the chief rabbi of Amsterdam used to spend 6 months a year in the Caribbean, plundering Spanish ships sailing back from Central America to, what am I telling you? Okay, I'm telling you because of this. Other than the fact that I love talking about the Jewish pirates of the Caribbean. Do you know one of the holiest days of the Jewish year is Yom Kippur? Does that ring a bell with anybody? It's called the Day of Atonement. Do you know that in the 17th century, Kingston Harbor was shut down on Yom Kippur? There were so many Jewish pirates. So if I sound inordinately proud of this, forgive me. Anyway, the thing about pirates, these were not real pirates, they were called privateers. And by the way, many British privateers caused the early United States of America tremendous problems. Mm-hmm. Tremendous problems. But ordinary pirates, what they used to do after a long and happy career of rape, robbing, pillage, and plunder, they would settle down in their old age in some nice Caribbean island like Nevis or St. Martin or many of the others. And you know what they did? They built a cathedral. They used their money to build a cathedral, thereby purchasing their way back into society. They expiated their sin of plunder and piracy. And that's why I tend to say, no, we don't make money to give it back. We make money to serve other human beings. And the money is evidence that I've served other human beings. Now, by the way, as with everything else, there are exceptions. Let us imagine that I like living in a neat and tidy neighborhood, and I teach my children to pick up litter and not throw wrappers on the ground. The fact is that it only takes one family on the block who doesn't feel that way to kind of spoil everything, you know?
As we saw tonight.
Thank you. A far better example. Exactly. And so, there are horrible business people. There's no question about it. There are horrible business people who, according to the spiritual rules of business, shouldn't prosper. But they do. In the same way that those people shouldn't have the benefit of being part of a terrific college. You would think that they had forfeited their rights, but they haven't, and they still do. The people who litter in a nice neighborhood still live in a nice neighborhood, even though their own behavior is bad. There are people, there are the Bernie Madoffs and hundreds of others of the world who are horrible people and who do not conduct their business in this way, and some of them prosper. You know why? Because they are part of a vibrant, powerful economy with massive economic inertia to it, and so they do okay, unfortunately. But ordinarily, yes, we make money in order to serve other people. And that's one of the reasons why, you know, people often say to each other, if they're sitting on a plane, you start talking to your seatmate, one of the earliest questions is, what do you do, right? What you really mean is, what do you do for a living? I never do that. I find that to be a very selfish-sounding question. I always say, how do you serve humanity? And then I usually get, well, what do you say? Well, like, you know, are you a social worker? Are you a bookkeeper? Are you a plumber? You mean what my area, what my profession is? I said, well, yeah, but what it really means is, how do you serve other people? Exactly, and that's one of the reasons that Judaism frowns on retirement. You know why? By the way, again, from my own personal religious point of view, I think God frowns on it too, because, God forbid, it's so sad, but I've noticed a lot of people who retire deteriorate in health almost right away.
Yeah.
Okay, let me tell you what the problem with retirement is. The problem with retirement is that it shows that you are working all along for yourself. And retirement means, hey, I've got enough. I'm going home. But how do I feel? I've been going to the same dentist, you know, for 20 years. I trust him. I love him. I don't even mind visiting him. One day I walk in, he says, well, this will be our last visit. I say, oh, really? I'm doing that well? He says, no, I'm retiring. I say, how dare you? He says, what do you mean? I don't need to work anymore. I've got enough investments. I say, oh, that's all very well for you. But what about me? I thought you cared about me. And you've just proved that you don't. How many of you play golf here? Okay, I don't. I know nothing about golf. One of the things I do know is something called follow through, right? Follow through. So here's what they tell me. It makes no sense at all. What they tell me is that after the club hits the ball, you can see it, it's sailing down the fairway. Now they tell me I must make absolutely sure that the club continues in an arc and ends up about there, would you say?
Yeah, well, probably.
Who cares? I've already hit the ball. If I balance the club on my nose, it's not going to make the ball veer off. Why do I have to do that? I should hit the ball and we're done. What's the answer? Even I can figure out the answer. The answer is, if I don't plan, the correct ending of the swing, it won't hit the ball right on the way. It's one long concerted moment. If I plan that the end of the story is when I got enough, I'm going home, retirement, then I'm not doing it right along the way. This isn't about getting enough. This is about taking a delight in serving other people. And that's why one of the very worst pieces of advice they give graduate students at college is, well, you're going out into the world now. Actually, you know what the real worst piece of advice is? Go into public service. That's a euphemism for being a politician. And I don't like hearing that because it means there's just another 10 fingers in my wallet every single time. But that's the worst advice. But here's the second worst advice given to students at graduation. You must now go out and find an occupation that you love doing, because that way, oh, you'll never work a day in your life. Terrible advice. Terrible advice. I love boating. Do you know that I'm still struggling to find somebody to pay me to go boating? If I'm interviewing somebody for a job, and 2 minutes into the interview, they say to me, what is the benefits and vacation policy? My answer is, thanks for the interview. Don't call us. We'll call you by the first opportunity that a meteorite strikes the planet. I'm not interested in somebody whose first thought is, what's in it for me? I understand you want to get paid, I understand you want benefits, and I'm trying to provide competitive ones. And if I don't get a good employee, I'll have to raise my benefits and my package. But what I really want to hire is the person who says, I'm here because I want to make your life easier. I'm going to improve your company's bottom line. I'm going to take away some of the aggravations in your life. You're hired right now. When you are told, find a job that you like doing, there couldn't be worse advice. Because no employer, frankly, cares what you like doing. We really don't. Not one little bit. Here's the secret. The secret is to find out what you should do, and then to learn to love it. How do you find out what you should do? Firstly, you may have a natural talent or God-given ability for some particular area. That's usually a tip-off. But the next tip-off, if that doesn't help you, the next tip-off is find something that will pay you absolutely the most money, because that will be the indication that you are providing the most benefit to other human beings. Find a way to earn the maximum you're capable of earning. Now, there are other things that come with it. There's things like security and guarantees and benefits. So you work out, what's the very best thing I can get for me? That's the work you should do and the work you should learn to enjoy doing. Anything else? Okay. Yes, sir.
Where do people with, like disabilities, people who aren't able-bodied enough to contribute, where they fit in?
Yeah, that's obviously what one of the things that a sane and benevolent society solves, obviously. Yeah, no, I mean, there's not a single person who resents giving help to people who are who have these handicaps. I think people resent having large portions of their paycheck taken to sustain multi-generational levels of welfare dysfunction. Yes, sir.
I have a question on your grandpa Lapin.
I'll give you his phone number. You talk to him.
So, what if they have different arbitrage profit ways? Like, for example, grandpa knocks on the door and says, "I'll pay you. You're going to pay $5, but I'll just pay you. I'll pay you $1 versus the $5 that you were going to give him." Or you can pay me $2 to try to maximize profit.
Sure.
So is that unethical?
The lady says, you know what? Thank you for stopping by, but I'm going to deal with Lapin. He promised me $5. I'd rather do $5 than $2 from you. Everybody acts in order to maximize their own interests, and then that works out well for everybody.
So then he has to pay. So in a sense, whoever that was.
Let me just tell you, almost every monopoly circumstance which is problematic is created by government. When there's a shortage of housing, that's because government has restricted the ability of people to build new housing. And then when people charge a lot of money for rent, they have to bring in rent control. Again, another governmental attempt to solve a problem that they shouldn't have created in the first place. So obviously those are bad circumstances. But otherwise, when everyone looks out for their own interests, magically, it actually works beautifully for everybody. And here's another thing to bear in mind. There's a phrase that politicians love using, which is the rich must pay their
fair share.
Fair share. Here's the interesting thing. Notice that they never define rich.
Or fair.
Or fair. And that's because neither of those two terms are capable of definition. Very simply, and last simple question. How much would I be willing to accept in order to move to Egypt? Got to relocate to live in Egypt. I tell you, well, I'll do it for $1 billion. And you say, no, I'm not paying you $1 billion to move to Egypt. I'll give you $1 million. And I say, you know what, I'm not moving to Egypt for $1 million. Then the person, you might say to me, well, can we agree that somewhere between $1 billion and $1 million is a figure that I'm willing to pay and you're willing to accept to move to Israel, to Egypt? So I think probably, I mean, I'm not willing to go for $1 million. I would go for $1 billion. Would I go for $500 million? Maybe. Would you be willing to pay $500 million for me to move? Maybe. So we could probably find a place. There's some number probably that we'd all be willing to pick up and move to, to some remote location, probably a lot of money. Change of question very slightly. How much money would you accept in order to move to live in 1917? To move your life 100 years earlier, how much would you accept?
$5.
And I would suggest to you that if you thought about what life was like for John D. Rockefeller in 1917, you wouldn't accept any amount of money to go back to a world without Novocaine,
yeah.
A world without iPhones. Now, it's true you could have afforded a house on Fifth Avenue, plus a house where Mayor Sutro had his mansion up just north of the Cliff House in San Francisco. You could do all that. But do you have any idea of how long it would take you to travel from New York to San Francisco in 1917? Right? 3.5 days. In non-air conditioned comfort. By train. I would submit to you that no amount of money would persuade you to move to 1917. And that's because the market has... I mean, if you think about all the things that make your life so pleasurable now, I mean, think of what you had to deal with in 1917. I'm not even going to tell you about birth control. 1917 was no fun, but if you were John D. Rockefeller, it was relative. Everyone had envied him back then, but nobody wants to be him today. Everything is relative. There is no definition for the word rich. It all depends on what people around you have. And there's no definition for the word fair. No word, no definition for it. It doesn't mean equal. What does fair mean? Nobody knows. And so whenever people use undefined words, you need to be very, very cautious. The rich must pay their fair share. What that translates as, whoever we decide is going to have to pay whatever we decide they should pay. That's what it translates as. Ladies and gentlemen, I do believe that we are kind of up to where we are. I'm very, very sorry. We sort of lost a bit of time with those degenerates. But here we are. I'm very grateful for the opportunity that I have had to share with you for a little bit this evening. Delighted I'm going to hang out. Anybody still wants to talk and chat a little bit, I'm here. I'd love it. I regard it as a privilege. Love to have a chance.
Thank you very much.